According to the CDC, 120 million Americans are missing at least one tooth in their mouth, and about 35 million Americans are missing all teeth in one or both jaws. This is a pretty substantive number.
There's a relationship between a healthy body and a healthy mouth, and that's very real.
And when people are missing teeth, they end up getting restored oftentimes with either with tooth-supported restorations or implant-supported restoration.
Virtually on any procedure in medicine, you're replacing a knee or a hip, you look up the current clinical practice guidelines. That gives you a template, a roadmap.
We needed well-defined guidelines as a profession simply because we had had a lot of anecdotal stories about what you should look for, how often you should examine patients, and no real set criteria.
In reviewing the evidence in the literature, we read over 5,000 articles for each of the two systematic reviews, and that boiled down to clinical practice guidelines that are very clear and simple. And a person doesn't have to read all those articles if they follow the clinical practice guidelines.
For the first time now, through this project, we were able to connect all the dots, assemble all the data, and provide one packaged document which all clinicians can refer to.
And I really applaud the ACP in wanting to develop clinical practice guidelines on maintenance and aftercare. The effort to develop the clinical practice guidelines were led by prosthodontists. We had input from the ADA, and we had input from the dental hygiene, and we had input from the general dentists.
There are 8 tips to take care of your restored teeth. And one is obtaining a professional dental examination at least every 6 months. The second is follow the dentist recommended at-home maintenance protocol specific to your situation. The third thing is very common. Brush your teeth with a fluoride-containing toothpaste twice a day. The scientific data to indicate this even for implant-supported restoration. And 4, floss at least once daily. The 5th is you wear a night guard if recommended by your dentist. 6th is use a mouthwash recommended by your dentist specific to your situation. 7 is do not smoke or chew tobacco. And finally, 8, do not consume foods with high sugar in them, which are in general are bad for your health.
People that follow maintenance programs generally do very well. When a person is not in a maintenance program, they have a 90% increased chance of losing their implant over a 15-year period.
Today was the first I had actually seen a placard with the guidelines.
They were pretty much standard practice, things that I've been accustomed to doing for a long time.
Well, I'm much more religious in terms of tending to things like daily brushings, and I use a prescription oral rinse.
The biggest takeaway for patients from the clinical practice guidelines is they need to be in an active partnership with their healthcare provider.
If you put the restoration I make you on a table, it'll last forever. But we all know that the mouth is a very dynamic place, and how we care for the restorations that are made is going to make a significant difference in their longevity.
When you go on a commercial plane, you see the pilot using a checklist. Clinical practice guidelines are kind of like that checklist. Even though that pilot has flown that plane, taken off 10,000 times, by using that checklist, it assures a more predictable result.
We have received overwhelming response so far. The clinical practice guidelines were simultaneously co-published in 4 different scientific journals, which have wide reach in our community.
We just finished with Mr. Schmidt. I'm a prosthodontist with a full-time teaching position at UCSF in San Francisco. I'll use these clinical practice guidelines with allied members of the healthcare field. You know, the hygienists, the assistants, the dental students that are training to become dentists in a way so that they're sensitized to the needs of patients.
This guideline now will actually help future researchers to use this as a benchmark, and then we will revise these guidelines as and when further scientific evidence becomes available and becomes mainstream.
The value of these guidelines really comes in the ability to standardize the care for our patients, but also it's something that we can refer to so that there's confidence when we're talking to a patient. Hey, this is what works for you. You've certainly put a significant investment into your dental treatment. This is how we're going to make it last for you.
My hope is that I can keep a good, healthy set of teeth going so that I don't have to worry about eating a good hard apple or chomping on an ear of corn. These are little things, I know, but they mean so much in terms of quality of life.